Welcome all to the worship of God on this Sabbath day, this gift that God gives us, a time to enter into God's grace and peace, to feel God's embrace and care, to join with one another as fellow travelers in faith. Special welcome to our guests. Whether you're here in person, whether you're online, we're delighted that you chose to worship with us today. We hope all of you, members and guests alike, will fill out the connection card so we can rejoice in your presence. Speaking of rejoicing, today is the first day of our Kids Corner up here in the front, a space set aside for younger worshipers and their friends and family. The passing of the peace is the time when you might realize you want to get closer or you want to get further away. So no shame in moving ourselves around during the passing of the peace. It's a joyful experiment, and we want to see how it works for everybody and make sure that everybody is happy and comfortable with it. So we'll take that time to readjust if we need to. We welcome those who are returning from trips, those who haven't been here in a while, those who are here all the time. It's all a joy. It takes a lot of people to make worship come together, make it pleasing to us and to God. So we're grateful, as always, for our tech team, our musicians, our worship leader, my colleague, the Reverend Sarah Schmidt-Lee. Yes, we do know each other. Coming into God's presence, let us rejoice in this moment and say together, no matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you are welcome here.
My name is Richard Benink. My wife Leslie and I have been members here for a little over 5 years. We are pleased to be a part of this congregation, and we are active in the community. I also enjoyed being part of the preaching team during our interim and had the experience of having a second retirement. Please join me for the call to worship. In you, gracious God, in you, the wounded find a healer, the penitent find a pardoner, the burdened find a counselor. In you, the miserly find a beggar, the despondent find a laughter maker. The legalists find a rule breaker, the prisoners find freedom. In you, Jesus Christ, we meet our maker and our match. Let us worship God, who is spirit and truth. You're invited to stand in body or in spirit for the opening hymn, which is number 361, followed by the prayer and the sung response. God of so many names, you command us to come to you, yet we doubt our abilities to make the journey. We are so uncertain of our steps, yet we long to have the faith in ourselves that you have in us. Be with us and embolden us through faith as we are called to walk with you and walk alongside those who need companionship. Show us how to be people of God who take up the mantle of faithful presence. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you. Let us share Christ's peace with one another.
You may be seated, and I'll invite any kids who would like to take part in this morning's blessing to come join me on the steps. Good morning. Is Ariel coming for a blessing too? Yay! Good morning. Mr. Video Game stayed at home. Well, we can send a blessing to him at home too.
He's literally
a stuffed controller. That sounds super cool. All right, so I'm going to tell you a short story today. You ready? It's a story that happened when I was 4 years old. Is anyone here 4 years old? No?
Cora's
almost four, so I was a little older than Cora.
I'm almost eight.
Are you five?
Yeah.
Cool. So you are the age of my friend. There's me and two friends in this story. Okay, and my friends were older than me. Chris was five, and Jeremy was seven. There's also a big swing in this story. You're seven? So you're the same age as the oldest kid in this story. Okay, so there was a big swing that was hanging from a tree branch. And my friends, Chris and Jeremy, who were 5 and 7 years old, they would swing on this swing. And while they were swinging, I could see them let go and hold their arms out to the side. And I thought that was amazing. It was almost magical. And so I tried it when I was on the swing. I let go, and I fell off. And I got hurt. It was terrible. See, my friends, they had a secret way of like connecting their arms to the swing that I didn't know about. Your dad swung you high and you fell off. Falling off a swing is no fun. Right. So today, the spoken word group, there's gonna be some people who stand up here at the microphones, and they're gonna tell us a story from the Bible about Jesus doing something that's even more amazing than my friends Jeremy and Chris letting go of the swing when they were swinging. And his disciples don't know how he did it. But one of them wants to try.
Wow.
Okay, so I want you to listen. I want you to listen for what it is that Jesus does, and I want you to listen for the disciple who tries it and see how it goes for them. Okay? So we'll listen when everybody's standing here at the microphones. Are you ready for today's blessing?
Yeah.
All right. Dear God, thank you for Jesus and amazing things we don't understand. Amen. Y'all can go back to your seats now. Thank you.
Immediately after feeding the 5,000, Jesus insisted that his disciples get back in the boat and crossed to the other side of the lake while he sent the people home.
After sending them home, he went up into the hills by himself to pray. Night fell while he was there alone.
Meanwhile, the disciples were in trouble, far away from land, for a strong wind had risen and they were fighting heavy waves.
About 3 o'clock in the morning, Jesus came toward them, walking on the water.
When the disciples saw him walking on the water, they were terrified. In their fear, they cried out,
It's a ghost!
But Jesus spoke to them at once.
Don't be afraid,
he said.
Take courage, I am here.
Then Peter called to him,
Lord, if it's really you, tell me to come to you walking on the water.
Yes, come,
Jesus said.
So Peter went over the side of the boat and walked on the water toward Jesus.
But when he saw the strong wind and the waves, he was terrified and began to sink.
Save me, Lord,
he shouted.
Jesus immediately reached out and grabbed him.
You have so little faith,
Jesus said.
Why did you doubt me?
When they climbed back into the boat, the wind stopped.
Then the disciples worshiped him. They exclaimed,
You really are the Son of God.
Hear
what the Spirit of God is saying
to the church.
Thanks be to God.
I imagine you have had this experience as I have. Rosalind Stone Zander says that once she needed to finish a book, and she decided that every weekend she would head to a little cabin with everything she needed to write. She arrived, unpacked the car, unloaded her dog, put sheets on the bed, took a walk, made a little dinner, had another glass of wine, finally sat down at her computer and managed to crank out one whole paragraph. The next weekend, the same thing happened. She arrived, took a walk, managed to crank out a second whole paragraph. On the third weekend of trying to work, she yelled out to the empty air, "This is hopeless." You may have had that same feeling, trying to clean out your house after living there for decades, trying to finish 5 college papers at a time. You're trying to do your taxes and all of a sudden you're watching football. You need to be doing the dishes and all of a sudden Stranger Things is on. You're staring at a pile of bills or a classroom full of unprepared kids. Or when one doctor shuffles you to another, to another, to another, you too might want to yell out, "This is hopeless." The gospel writer doesn't say, but we might imagine that Peter and his friends want to shout the same thing when they're all alone and the storm comes up. They're already tired. As we heard last week from Pastor Sarah, they have fed the crowd. And now Jesus has sent them on alone. And their day gets longer and longer and longer as the storm comes up, as they wrestle with the wind and the waves, ready to yell, "This is hopeless," out into the storm. When Jesus comes walking over the water, they're not even sure that it's him. They have that moment of doubt. And so Peter offers this test. And in response, Jesus offers an invitation. "Come on, walk on the water with me." And Peter does it, right until the moment when he starts to think too hard about it, when he starts to think, "This is hopeless." After all these weekends of getting nothing done, Rosalind Zander says she had to do something different to finish her book. Finally, she decided that everything I do at the cabin is writing. walking the dog, taking a nap, making food, reading the newspaper, playing solitaire online, all of those things are writing. It's all part of the process. Even when her fingers were not on the keyboard, her brain was working on the book. And what if that's true for us too? What if everything is faith? What if everything is part of our connection to God? The farmer's market and gardening, putting kids to bed, doing paperwork, looking at our finances, driving, singing, going to meetings, folding towels, all are part of our faith. All are part of being with God. And so is failing. And so is falling. Peter steps out of that boat full of confidence. And only when his head takes over and he starts to think, this is hopeless, it'll never work, it's foolish, who am I to think that I can walk on the water, does he fall into the waves. And Jesus reaches out his hand. The falling into the water is as much a part of our faith as walking on the water. The moments when we're ready to scream, this is hopeless. We're still in the middle of God's work. We're still ready to be caught by God. The times when we're battling the storm and the times when we're sitting quietly in God's presence are equally part of our faith. The times when, by God's grace, we glide over the water. And the times when we take in a mouthful of water on our way down. It's all part of our faith. It's all our connection to God. It's all being in God's presence. When we hear Jesus talk to the disciples about having little faith, it sounds like a judgment. Take a minute to think about how you hear that voice in your head. Many of us grew up in churches where it sounds harsh. We were raised to hear it as a judgment, as a sign that we should be doing something better. But one writer says that it's an affectionate nickname. In the original language, it's a made-up word, which Jesus uses only for the disciples. It's an endearment for close friends. It can be understood in the vein of, ah, my worried little friends, are you fretting again? Translated into English, it might go something like, you little worriers, or you little faithies. He's teasing them the way our friends tease us about our coffee habit, or our snoring, or the color we wear all the time. Picture Jesus saying it with love, the way your friends talk to you. The author adds that Matthew seems to believe that the people of little faith are the ones worth teaching. The people who step out and fall into the water are the people there's hope for. Little faith is still a part of faith. Worrying is part of faith. Falling is faith. Failing is faith. Knowing that, we can fail better. We can fail bigger. We can take a chance on falling into the water, knowing that Jesus is going to reach out and catch us. We can fail at brand new things, so we keep learning. All of it is our connection to God. All of it takes place in the presence of Jesus, who looks at us with affection, who teases us when our faith is too small, who reaches out to grab us and catches us when we fall and when we fail and when we do everything else, because it's all part of our faith. In Jesus' name, amen.
seated. Having heard the word from God, we respond to God with thanksgiving. The ushers will be coming forward to receive your offerings, and I would also invite you to deposit your connection card in the offering basket, or if you don't have time to fill it out now, you can deposit it by the doors as you leave. Thank you.
God, we give you thanks for all the ways that you sustain us and all the gifts you have given us. Today, we return to you these gifts of gratitude, and we dedicate them to your work of justice and love in Kalamazoo and in the world. Amen. You may be seated. In our prayers this morning, we will continue to participate in the Southwest Association Prayer Project. This week, we will be praying for Zion St. Joseph UCC Church and their pastor, the Reverend Glennis Grinstaff, who's their interim. We know that each week, as we pray for another church in this region, that someone in the Southwest region of Michigan is praying for us as well. I invite you to take a look at the joys and concerns on the yellow insert in your bulletin so that you know some of the specific people that you can keep in prayer and who are included in our prayers this morning, even though we don't name them. Part of the reason that we don't always name people specifically in these prayers is because they're live streamed on the internet, and not everybody wants all of those details broadcast to the world. But you know who those people are. They're in your bulletin. Let us join our hearts together in prayer. We give you thanks, God, for sunshine, for the explosion of colors in gardens all around the city, and the way that Scott has translated that into our altarscape. We give you thanks for breezes that ease the heat. We give you thanks for travels and returns from travels, for the opportunity to reunite, the opportunity to meet new people, explore new places. We give you thanks, God, for all of the teachers and school administrators who are working hard to prepare for students who will be beginning and later this month. We pray for peace and for energy, for joy and creativity as a new school year begins. We give you thanks this morning for our kinfolk at Zion UCC in St. Joe. We pray for their interim pastor, Reverend Grinstaff, and for all of their leaders as they move through a season of transition and seek their next pastor. We pray that they would know your spirit moving in their midst. God, we also hold before you places of need in our world. And in particular, we think of the residents on Maui who are grieving the loss of their community, the loss of lives, the loss of their homes and businesses. We pray that they might find comfort, that they might see through the ash and the smoke to possibilities for recovery. We pray for churches in that community and all around the country that are working hard to offer relief, to bring hope. We pray that through their efforts, through the gifts that we are able to give, that those who have lost so much might find some small measure of comfort. We pray for those in our own community who are grieving, grieving the loss of loved ones, grieving lost opportunities, grieving changes in our bodies. We pray for those who are in hospital or in recovery, in rehab, at home, or in other places. We pray for strength, for an easing of pain. We hold all of these needs before you, God, along with those that we carry silently in our hearts, trusting that you are present in every place where our heart aches, and that your presence brings healing, brings peace, brings justice, and brings joy. It's with confidence, as those who are called your beloved, that we continue to pray that prayer Jesus taught his disciples, saying together, Our Mother, Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Good morning. My name is Christy Droppers, and I'm the moderator for this calendar year. Welcome to all of you who made it in this heat and all of you who are online. I first just want to say to Caitlin, who I know has joined her family in the pew, thank you. It was fabulous. Thank you so much. I also want to bring your attention to the fact that you might not have noticed, but maybe you will in future Sundays. Our bell rang this morning around 10 a.m. thanks to Harvey, who has so graciously volunteered to ring the bell for us on every Sunday. And if you don't know Harvey, he just raised his hand. Make sure you say thank you to him. Thank you, Harvey. So, just a couple special announcements you probably have already seen. I hope many of you will join. Today, we're not going to one of our congregants' lovely gardens. We're going to do a summer garden social by taking a walk, a nature walk, right after church. They're going to meet in the parking lot, at the Portage Creek Bicentennial Trail, which is basically begins at Lover's Lane and Kilgore. There are directions right on the front desk. There will be people who will guide you, talk about nature from our congregation. It should be a really nice, special time. If you can, grab something to bring along to eat so you can have a little picnic. If you have any questions, seek out Pam Mosley, who is sitting at the front desk, and she will guide you. Second, we are having an immediate meeting after church with choir members and all of those in worship arts in the choir room. At this meeting, Pastor Mary is going to facilitate, and they're going to have a discussion about asking those members if they have special needs or thoughts that are important to them as we are pulling together a search team to fulfill Cindy's successor. This will be a conversation about qualifications and process, not personalities or specific people. We'll meet in the choir room immediately following, and HR members will be there to listen. Please, if you can, go immediately after you grab your cup of coffee or water. Those are the announcements for today. One last thing, we've really lucked out in weather. I know it's hot today, but it's not crazy. Would you all please join with me as we pray together the prayer of the church? As members of Christ's body and of one another, unique parts of a beloved whole, we give thanks for this gathering and for the one who gathers us. May our time together bind us in spirit, strengthen us for service, and help us reflect God's love in all we do. Amen. Please join us and stand if you are able in singing our closing hymn, Lord, You Have Come to the Lakeshore, number 377.
Friends, let us go forth, whether it is to familiar seas or to new ones. Whether we go with great faith or whether we fumble, not sure we have enough. Let us go forth knowing that God's love surrounds us, that the presence of the Spirit goes with us, that the grace of Jesus Christ is everlasting. Amen.